Hello students, today we are going to start a new lesson of history, lesson 3, ruling the countryside. In this chapter, we will study how the company came to colonize the countryside, organize revenue resources, redefine the rights of the people and produce the crops it wanted. We have studied that on 12th August 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the East India Company as the Diwan of Bengal. As Diwan, the company became the chief financial administrator of the territory under its control. Now it had to think of administering the land and organizing its revenue resources. This had to be done in a way that could yield enough revenue to meet the growing expenses of the company. The trading company had also to ensure that it could buy the products it needed and sell what it wanted. So now for the company to earn revenue, it started devising various plans. Even though the company had become the Diwan, it still saw itself primarily as a trader. It wanted a large revenue income but was unwilling to set up any regular system of assessment and collection. The effort was to increase the revenue as much as it could and buy fine cotton and silk cloth as cheaply as possible. With the assumption of Diwani, the revenue collected in Bengal could finance the purchase of goods for export and so the import of gold and silver from Britain to buy goods in India stopped. Soon it was clear that the Bengal economy was facing a deep crisis. Artisans were deserting villages since they were being forced to sell their goods to the company at low prices. Peasants were unable to pay the dues that were being demanded from them. Artisanal production was in decline and agricultural cultivation showed signs of collapse. Then in 1770, a terrible famine killed 10 million people in Bengal and about one third of the population was wiped out. So now most of the company officials began to feel that the investment in land had to be encouraged and agriculture had to improve to maintain a steady flow of revenue. During the tenure of Governor General Lord Cornwallis, the company finally introduced permanent settlements. And in this chapter, we are going to read about the various land settlements which the British introduced, like the permanent settlement in Bengal, Rayatwari settlement in Madras, Mahalwari in Northwest provinces and in Bombay, and then about the Sepoy Mutiny and Talukdari in Awadh, we'll read in the next chapter. For this chapter, major are the three land settlements introduced by British: permanent settlement, Rayatwari settlement and Mahalwari settlement. So permanent settlement was introduced by Lord Cornwallis, Rayatwari system by Thomas Munro and Mahalwari system by Lord William Bentinck. Permanent settlement was introduced in Bengal, Bihar, Orissa. So the region is shown there. Rayatwari in South India, Mahalwari in Northwest India. Tax collected by zamindars in the permanent settlement. Then in the Rayatwari system, tax was collected by the company directly. And in Mahalwari system, the village headman was assigned the task of collecting the revenue from the village and handing it over to the company officials. In the permanent settlement, the landowner was the zamindars. In Rayatwari system, the landowners or the Rayats or the farmers, they were the main landowners. And in Mahalwari system, it was a mix of both permanent and the Rayatwari system, where the landlords, actually the whole village, was assigned the task of paying the taxes. But the tax burden ultimately fell on the farmers. Taxes were very high, which were imposed on them, and it kept on increasing frequently in Rayotwari and Mahalwari, but in permanent settlement, the tax was fixed. So now let us understand what the permanent settlement was. During the tenure of Governor General Lord Cornwallis, the company finally introduced the permanent settlement in 1793 in Bengal. By the term of the settlement, the Rajas and Talukdars were recognized as Zamindars. So, they were recognized as the sole owners of the land. They were asked to collect rent from the peasants and pay revenue to the company. The amount to be paid was fixed permanently. That is, it was not to be increased ever in future. It was felt that this would ensure a regular flow of revenue into the company's coffers and at the same time encourage the zamindars to invest in improving the land. Since the revenue demand of the state would not be increased, the zamindar would benefit from increased production from the land. However, the company officials soon discovered that the permanent settlement had its shortcomings. Firstly, the zamindars were not investing in the improvement of land. As long as the zamindars could give out the land to the tenant and get rent, they did not want to improve the quality of land. Secondly, the revenue that had been fixed was so high that the zamindars found it difficult to pay. Anyone who failed to pay the revenue lost his zamindari rights, and the zamindaris were sold off at auctions organized by the company. Since the revenue was fixed, an increase in the income of the zamindars did not lead to gain for the company. So all this worked against the company's wishes. And on the other hand, in the villages, the cultivator found the system extremely oppressive. The rent he paid to the zamindar was high and his right on the land was insecure. To pay the rent, he had to often take loans from the moneylenders, and when he failed to pay the rent, he was evicted from the land that he had been cultivating for generations. So these were the drawbacks of the Permanent Settlement Act. By the early 19th century, many of the company officials were convinced that the system of revenue had to be changed again because the revenue could not be fixed permanently when the company needed more money to meet the expenses of administration and trade. So, in the northwestern provinces of Bengal Presidency, a system called the Mahalwari system was introduced by Lord William Bentinck. Mahal meant a village and hence the name Mahalwari. In this system, the estimated revenue of each plot within a village was added up to calculate the revenue that each village had to pay. So the land was assessed by the officials sent by the company. For this, the collectors went from village to village, inspected the land, measured the fields, and recorded the customs and rights of different groups. This demand for revenue was revised periodically and it was not to be fixed permanently. The charge of collecting the revenue and paying it to the company was given to the village headman rather than to the zamindars. And since the village was made the unit for paying the revenue, and village was also known as Mahal, so the system came to be known as the Mahalwari system. You can see from here, Mahalwari system of the north and central provinces was another system of revenue collection. According to this system, the company collected taxes remitted by village heads or heads of joint families and not from the individual farmers. These land revenue systems were not favorable to the farmers. So everywhere you will see that the land revenue system, which was devised by the British, was not favorable to the Indian farmers. If the crops were destroyed or the harvest declined due to adverse climatic conditions, the peasants were not given any reduction in their revenue. So whichever system was devised by them, it kept on failing. In the British territories in the south, a new system was introduced by Thomas Munro in 1822. This came to be known as the Ryotwari system. Land was measured taking into account its fertility and irrigation facilities in this system. Revenue was collected with the help of local hereditary officers. There was periodical assessment of the land revenue. This system was introduced mostly in southern and western India. So under this settlement, it was argued by the company officials that the revenue settlement had to be made directly with the cultivators or the ryots, thus the name Ryotwari system. The ryots who had tilled the land for generations, their fields had to be carefully and separately surveyed by the revenue assessment by the revenue officials, and then the assessment was to be made. Munro thought that the British should act as paternal father figures protecting the ryots. But within a few years, the company officials realized that all these land settlements to gain and earn more and more revenue from the farmers was not correct for the Indian system. Here you can see Ryotwari system was introduced by Thomas Munro. The date here is 1820. Major areas of introduction include Madras, Bombay, parts of Assam and Coorg provinces of British India. In Ryotwari system, the ownership rights were handed over to the peasants, also known as the ryots. The British government collected taxes directly from the peasants. The revenue rates of Ryotwari system were 50% where the land were dry and 60% in irrigated areas. But within a few years, all the new systems, wherever it was imposed, it became clear that they were not working in the proper manner or the desired manner. Because driven by the desire to increase the income from land, revenue officials fixed too high a revenue demand. Peasants were unable to pay. Ryots fled the countryside and villages became deserted in many regions. The optimistic officials had imagined that the new system would transform the peasants into rich, enterprising farmers, but this did not happen. So ultimately, the farmers were the ones who suffered at the hands of these British officials or the zamindars or the local headmen, because whatever the revenue was demanded by the company, it was too high for them to pay. Here you can see comparison between permanent Ryotwari and Mahalwari system at a single glance. So it was initiated, permanent settlement was initiated by Lord Cornwallis, Ryotwari by Munro and Mahalwari by Holt Mackenzie and William Bentinck. It was executed in Bengal, the other one was in Madras and Bombay, and Mahalwari in the northwest frontier provinces. The land revenue was fixed in the permanent settlement, whereas in Ryotwari and Mahalwari it was not fixed. It had to be updated periodically. The British officials entered into settlement directly with the zamindars in the permanent settlement. In the Ryotwari, the authorities entered into the settlement with actual ryot or the owners of the land. And in the Mahalwari system, the authorities entered into settlement with the village community where they held land in common tenancy or with the landlords. In permanent settlement, no assessment of the land was made, but in Ryotwari and Mahalwari, assessment of the land was done. And here you can see the causes of failure. The causes of failure for permanent settlement was the peasants lost the right of their lands. Zamindars were not investing in the improvement of land. The zamindars oppressed the cultivators for more revenue. The system was harsh and rigid. And lastly, since the revenue was fixed, an increase in the income of zamindars did not lead to gain for the company. Causes of failure of Riyotwari system was the cultivator was required to pay a fixed sum of rent irrespective of the actual yield. The assessment of the rent was not done by agents, was done by agents who made unfair extortions. And the causes of failure for Marwari system or Marwari settlement, no more inquiries were made for assessment. State demand of revenue was very high. So in today's video, we have studied about the three different types of land revenue settlements introduced by the British. And we saw the dates when they were introduced, who introduced, what was the causes of failure. So I would like you all to read the chapter thoroughly. And then in the next video, we'll deal with the indigo cultivators. But before we wind up, I would like you to prepare lesson 1 and 2 of history for a class test on Thursday. So please read the chapter very thoroughly, because it will be MCQ test of 10 marks. I will let you the timing and let you know the timings through Campus Care. So be prepared for a test of lesson 1 and 2 on Thursday for history. Thank you.